electronic components to boost his troubled mechanical TV. But Baird remained reluctant to give up his system. By the mid-30s, Germany was a leading contender in the TV race, with a regular service of low-definition pictures opening in 1935. Despite Dr. Goebbels' appearance at a Berlin TV exhibition that year, surprisingly, the Nazis did not directly exploit television's propaganda potential. Hitler never spoke on TV, and the service mainly transmitted novelties to a tiny handful of public sets in Berlin.
What the British were intending to do at the end of 35, we could do well beforehand, that very day even. And so, on March 22, 1935, from one day to the next, the first TV service in the world began.
Britain has always been reluctant to see this system born in Nazi Germany as a winner of the race for TV. The 180 line pictures were much cruder than the 405 line service the BBC would open within months. But certainly in the studio of the Berlin Post Office, Ursula Patschke became a candidate for the first TV announcer.
I had a dog who always went with me. Time would drag, but what else was I supposed to show? I left my seat, got the dog to jump up into it, made him sit up and beg, told him to say woof, and then he said woof, of course. People were intrigued.
In Berlin before the war, when I was Daily Telegraph correspondent, there was a video telephone service opened between Berlin and Leipzig. I think it was on March 1st, 1936.
Hallo?
Tag Helga. Na siehst du, da bin ich selbst.
Na wunderbar.
And now the German press is writing as if a new service, which is just about to start, was the first ever.
Within months, the new German TV service boldly televised the 1936 Berlin Olympic Games. Though the audience was still tiny and largely restricted to viewing rooms in Berlin and Hamburg. The cameraman working with the newly developed equipment was Walter Bruch.
The place where the camera stood was exactly the finishing line, over there, of the 100-meter sprint. We were therefore able to broadcast how Jesse Owens won the gold medal at the time. So it was a wonderful and unforgettable experience for me.
I'm
not an athlete, and I saw all that through the camera. And I had, you could say, a better place down there than Hitler.
The final lap of the race for television was to be fought out in Britain between Baird and his rival, EMI. In September 1935, after 1,500 programs, Baird's experimental transmission was finally closed down by the BBC. A government report recommended a final and decisive competition between Baird's mechanical television and the Marconi EMI electronic system in a six-month trial. A studio took shape at Alexandra Palace, 12 miles north of London, aiming for a start date in November 1936. But in a last-minute attempt to boost sales at the Radio Olympia exhibition in August, transmissions began with the manicured voice of Elizabeth Cowell.
Hello, Radio Olympia. This is direct television from the studios at Alexandra Palace. And now you're going to see and hear someone you know well, Miss Helen Mackay.
The British press was suddenly excited about television and suspicious. Can television see into your home? Asked the Daily Express. Will television sterilize the population? The Daily Telegraph suggested some exotic names for television viewers. Telesia, Televist, Order observer, order this. Invider, telegazer, visioneer, beholder, opticarius, ingazer, and bearder. Viewer was rejected. Three months later, on November the 2nd, 1936, the BBC opened the world's first high-definition television service with another song, Adele Dixon's Magic Rays of Light. The Times wrote, "The moment long seen afar off by eyes of faith has come at last." But the final sprint in the race for television was still to be won, and the signs didn't look good for Baird at the opening ceremony.
He came to Alexander Palace that day. But apparently nobody thought that he should be invited. It was thought only important executives and government people should take part. And the poor man was left wandering up and down the passage, waiting to be invited, and never was. Wasn't that sad?
From the start, Studio A at Alexandra Palace used the EMI electronic system. Studio B was fitted up with a new and desperate variation of Baird's mechanical system. In the new Baird system, a film camera recorded each picture and the exposed film was immediately processed in a tank. The film, still wet, was scanned by a rotating disc, changing the pictures to electric impulses, which were then magnified for television transmission. Baird had incorporated some of the electronic elements supplied from America by Farnsworth, but refused to give up his mechanical disc. The pictures were usually good, but the machine was very noisy and massively inflexible. Worst of all, it regularly broke down. The man responsible for organizing the new BBC service was Cecil Madden. His budget for the entire opening week was £1,000.
So in the first week, we were able to say that we'd done a play, a ballet, and an opera, two editions of Picture Page, a variety show on the Saturday night, and a good many items all round in between. So we opened really pretty big.
And as I drove in and out from Alexandra Palace, every day one used to look for the television aerial on somebody's house and say, there's one. And 5 miles later you'd say, there's a new one. We're getting viewers at last.
Picture Page. The first British magazine programme was introduced by the switchboard girl, Joan Miller. She recalls the hazards of the final TV race.
And very, very often indeed, the camera on perhaps the victim who was being interviewed at the time broke down, whereupon you would see the boys all clustering round, taking her down. And then you would suddenly see my camera coming, rushing up to me, and they, upstairs, I would hear the voice, Joan, the camera's gone, start talking.
The main interviewer on Picture Page was ex-radio announcer Leslie Mitchell. His screen career began with a shock.
I went into my office one morning, and my secretary was there in a great state of dither, with the front page of the Daily Mail, and held it up and said, look at this, and said above it, television Adonis found. On the BBC staff all the time. It was me. We were prepared to do anything, though, in those days, and we tried our damnedest.
Here's Leslie Mitchell, almost a fireman. His nibs hangs heroically to the top of a ladder.
And then on another occasion, the fire brigade did another show in which Jasmine Bligh was supposed to have found herself enveloped in flames and stood on the ledge outside her window while they sent up a gallant gentleman to rescue her and carry her down. She was no small weight. Anyway, she got down safely, and all was well.
Saved. Hoorah!
At the beginning of 1937, the weekly battle between the hard-pressed system of John Logie Baird and the more sophisticated electronic studio of EMI and Marconi was reaching a crisis.
The things in Marconi EMI were very easy and smooth, and it all worked perfectly. But in the Baird studio, there were complications. The thing often broke down. Bubbles appeared on the films. And quite frankly, the artist just didn't want to appear on it. Quite important people came and practically prayed at my desk, saying, don't put us on in the Baird week. So I think the finger of doom was on it.
In February 1937, John Logie Baird was finished. The decision was made to drop his system, and EMI was declared the winner. After 15 years of pioneering effort, Baird's race was over. His rivals in the race for television acknowledged his contribution.
John Logie Baird was, I believe, an excellent propagandist for television. He was thoroughly convinced, I'm sure, that television was the thing of the future.
It was the richest person who won. In other words, EMI won. And it was from that moment on that Baird was on the sidelines. And for my part, I understand the pain and sorrow he must have felt to have failed in this way. And in reality, television owes much more to Baird than it does to EMI.
For the new BBC channel, there was an early challenge in the spring of 1937 with the coronation of King George VI. It was television's first big occasion, watched by thousands.
I really did think we were really breaking new ground, that this was showing the great possibilities of television, because seeing something while it was happening, some event while it was happening, was always thought in our minds at that time, and I think in public minds too, as the real job of television. It was always proclaimed by Baird and others that soon you'll be sitting in your home seeing the Derby and events in all parts of the world coming live to you, sitting in your armchairs, that kind of thing, you see. And this is what we thought in those days really was what television was for.
By the late 30s, television services were springing up across Europe. But they were still broadcasting to tiny audiences. In France, by 1938, there were still only 400 sets. In Germany, an accomplished and ambitious service was televising to just 11 public viewing rooms. And in the Soviet Union, where a TV receiver still cost as much as a car, there were only a few hundred sets by the late 30s. In America, after the years of experimentation and commercial wrangling, television was at last poised for a major launch in 1939. The New York World's Fair, opened by President Roosevelt on April the 30th, was to be the curtain raiser. Prophetically, the opening ceremony was staged especially for TV. It was televised by David Sarnoff's National Broadcasting Company to an audience of about 1,000 people.
I hereby dedicate the World's Fair, the New York World's Fair of 1939. And I declare it open to all mankind.
David Sarnoff used the World's Fair to announce a new era of commercial television. The next day, RCA offered 25 different models of TV sets for sale. But once again, the plans for television in America were halted by suspicious authorities. In Britain, after almost 3 years of BBC television, with an audience now approaching 100,000, the first era of TV was almost at an end.
And then, of course, the famous day came. I think it was September the 1st, 1939, when it was decided from Broadcasting House that television must stop. And so a message was simply given to the engineers at Alexandra Palace, switch off everything, it's over. And it just so happened that it was in the middle of a film. It was a film, I think, is called Mickey's Hollywood Premiere or something like that.
Congratulations, Mr. Mickey Mouse. Congratulations, it's a
halfway through, if you please. They hadn't even the courtesy or the taste to let us finish the film. They just cut it off like that.
I think I'll meet you now.
And the screen went blank. And that was the end of television for the war, because there was a fear that enemy bombers could zoom in on the aerial, which was a wonderful guide to London.
They've made several successful hits on tanks.
Television went to war. In Britain, the war effort absorbed trained television technicians into the country's radar network. Television cameras installed in bombers reported on bomb damage. But some witnesses suggest a closer connection between national defense and Britain's pioneering television service.
But after a year, I ran into Lord Swinton, who had been the Air Minister. He said, "What are you doing?" I said, "Well, I've been radar for the last few years." And he said, "And before?" I said, "I was television." And he said, "Well, do you realize that actually Britain started public service television because we had invented radar, we knew a war was likely to come, and we wouldn't have had the production facilities to manufacture the cathode ray tubes if we hadn't had public service television going. And we got it on the air in time, so that the moment war started, not only could we use the engineers, but we could use the production facilities to manufacture the radar for the Army, the Navy, and the Air Force, which helped us win the Battle of Britain."
In the Soviet Union and America, the war wiped television off the screens. But in Nazi-occupied Europe, it was a different story. Suspended briefly during the invasion of Poland, German television continued for another 4 years. While television continued to entertain the troops, the Nazi government planned the production of 5,000 home receivers after the war was won. Occupied Paris in 1940. Hitler's army was followed by German television, and the station manager was sent from Berlin to take charge.
At that time, in Paris, all the hospitals whose patients included German soldiers could watch us. Suitable receivers had been set up everywhere. In Paris, we had the biggest television studio in the world and the world's most powerful transmitter. It couldn't have been better.
TV culture for the Wehrmacht, a ballet by the director of the Paris Opera House. But on the other side of the channel, as the war drew to a close, BBC television was preparing for a comeback.
"I want you back most of the time for a postcard effect, unless I ask you to go into a close-up. Number three on the low tripod, down for the stunt shots. And number two, you start on the caption, keep screwed up high, and after the first caption, turn and dolly onto the set."
And it was all kept terribly secret that the studios had been reopened. And so I got hold of the windmill girls, who never let anyone down. And they came with all their dresses and things like that and soon settled down.
The windmill girls program was, in fact, a closed circuit test not seen by the viewing public. But soon, British television was to be back on the screen.
It was all done very quickly, and really it was so extraordinary to be doing television in the war after all those years of Bleak and Blitz and V1s and V2s and all the disasters we'd had. It was in February 1945, which was before VE Day or VJ Day. So it was television in the war, and that hasn't really been known to anybody up to now.
As the BBC struggled out of the war, the death of John Logie Baird signalled the end of the first era of television. But a remarkable prophecy of television's explosive future went almost unnoticed.
published in a small specialist magazine in October 1945. An article written by Arthur C. Clarke proposed in detail a visionary scheme for a television satellite. It would be 17 years before Telstar opened the new race for television. Next week, the story of live TV, from sports to royal weddings.